Hello friends, my name is JJ, and in this week's video, we are going to talk about something that I have always wondered about, but never done much research into until now. Why are some British men called Sir? Obviously, we all know on some level that men who are called Sir are men that have been knighted by the Queen with the sword and all that. But how does it actually work? And what are some contemporary issues and controversies with the Sirs? Let us find out. So, turning men into Sirs is one of the longest running British traditions there is. The very first British Prime Minister was a Sir, as were a whole bunch of other historical British big shots, like Sir Isaac Newton, Sir Thomas More, Sir Francis Drake, even Sir William Wallace. In the Middle Ages, the practice of knighting men into sirs was something that was only done for actual knights, with the armor and all the rest, who had pledged their undying loyalty to the British king. But as the Middle Ages came to a close in the 16th century, and Britain began to edge closer towards something resembling the modern era, a lot of medieval British traditions were sort of gradually retooled into more symbolic versions of themselves. So, like, instead of running around with actual shields, people started to just put pictures of shields on their corporate letterhead or whatever. And instead of living in real castles with turrets and moats, rich people just started living in big houses that they would call castles. And instead of having actual knights, the king would just reward the loyalty of normal people, who he would call knights. And once kings stopped being important, this concept got even more abstract, with the new bureaucratic British government rewarding people who had proven their loyalty to Britain in some broad sense. We are now actually at a point where more of British history has actually featured this modern symbolic type of knight compared to the suit of armor kind. All right, so now let us talk a bit about what knights are like these days. Many of the knights walking around in Britain today are some of the world's biggest celebrities, movie stars like Sir Daniel Day-Lewis and Sir Ian McKellen, but there are also plenty of less famous sirs as well, like Sir Hugh Robertson, the chair of the British Olympic Committee, Sir Jim McDonald, the president of Britain's Royal Academy of Engineering, or Sir Simon Stevens, the head of the British National Health Service. So clearly a pretty eclectic bunch, but who picks them? Well, the power remains with the British government, and these days the British government appoints 10 committees that both nominate and receive nominations for British men who are deemed worthy of becoming knights. I should just note here that I'm focusing on men in this video only because women cannot become knights. Women can become dames, which is sort of similar, but not exactly the same, and some of the traditions and customs are a bit different. So for the purposes of simplicity, we are only going to talk about sirs in this video. I mean, I've looked at my channel demographics, I know what side my bread is buttered on. So anyway, there are 10 committees, and each one is on a mission to find men worthy of being sirs in 10 different categories of British life, and they are art, politics, sports, charity and volunteerism, economics, education, health, science and technology, state, which is like foreign policy type stuff, and non-political government service. Then there is a main committee that oversees all of the other committees, and because we live in enlightened times, there is also an inclusion and diversity committee to ensure that the picks are all diverse and inclusive. About 75% of all knighthoods are selected by the committees on their own, while an additional quarter are made based on recommendations from the public. In theory, anyone can nominate anyone for a knighthood. Just go on the website and download the PDF. Now, who sits on all of these committees, you surely ask? Well, they tend to be comprised of purported experts in the field at hand. So there are a lot of doctors on the health committee and that sort of thing. And all of the chairmen of the committees are either knights or dames themselves, so presumably they have some useful insight into standards. The committees usually name 50 to 60 new sirs a year, with the names being revealed on one of two dates. The first being New Year's Day, January 1st, and the second being about halfway through the year, on the second Saturday in June, which is the day that the Brits recognize as Queen Elizabeth's official birthday, which is different than the date of her actual birth for some reason. Now, most knighthoods are given out on one of those two days, but There are two notable exceptions. British prime ministers are allowed to appoint a few knights at their own discretion when they retire, in what are known as the resignations honors. An old queenie is allowed to appoint a few knights at her own discretion as well, usually members of her own family. She made Prince Harry a knight in 2015, for example. Sir Prince Harry, or maybe Prince Sir Harry. Okay, so once the choice has been made, here is what happens next. According to Mo Farah, the famed British Olympic runner, who was knighted in 2017.
First of all, you get the letter in the post and you have to open it up and they tell you not to share with anyone. You're not only share with family members, and they give you a date and you have to put that forward and who you're gonna bring and fill that, all that stuff in. And then finally the day came yesterday where I went to see her. It was me and my wife and a friend of mine. We went in and they check your bags. They go through whole security, and then you get, they procedure you what's gonna happen, and they give you demonstrations of how the queen's gonna come out and what you have to do. And it was nice. I walked in there, you go through, and you nod your head, you go through, and then, you know, I put my leg on the chair, one leg, and with a knife, just did that. And then she gives you a medal and then you had a decent conversation with me.
Now, because the Brits are obsessed with making elaborate, complicated hierarchies for everything, there are something like 6 different flavors of knight. The most elite being Knights of the Garter, or Knights of the Bath. And then these are further subdivided into tiers like Knights of the Grand Cross, or Knights Commanders, or lowly old Knights Bachelor, which is what Ringo Starr is. There are different quotas for each different type of knight, and depending on what type of knight you are, you get to put different letters after your name on your official knight business card, and you get a different medal during your knighthood ceremony. Some types of knights even get official robes, as seen here with Sir John Major, the former British Prime Minister, who is a knight of the Order of the Garter. But what matters most is that all types of knights are sirs. It actually gets even more confusing because the Brits have all of these other official honors with equally grand titles that the government gives to famous people as well. And I've noticed that these sometimes get mixed up with knighthoods. So for example, there is a thing called the Order of the British Empire, or OBE, which is what Gordon Ramsay, Benedict Cumberbatch, David Beckham, and Idris Elba have. But it doesn't make them sirs. And then there's the whole business of becoming a British lord, which is this whole other complicated topic. Lords are men appointed by the British government to serve in the upper chamber of the British Parliament, the House of Lords. Although there are other types of lords as well. Just watch Jay Foreman's video about it. Okay, so what does being a sir actually mean? Well, the biggest thing is that it means you will be called Sir So-and-so forever. The Brits actually consider Sir to be part of your legal name after you've been knighted, and you're able to use it on your passport and driver's license and all the rest. The proper way that you are supposed to address someone who has been knighted is Sir First Name, so like Sir Anthony or Sir David or whatever, not Sir Hopkins or Sir Attenborough. But this is where things get interesting for me as a journalist. Obviously, a lot of famous people have been knighted, and famous people are often talked about in the newspapers and TV. So I was curious, how are knighted people referred to in the British news media? The answer is, it varies. On the BBC, the leading news outlet in Britain, they always refer to knighted people as Sir whatever. So for example, when famed James Bond actor Sir Roger Moore died, the BBC's obituary always referred to him as Sir Roger, as in Sir Roger's Bond was calm and suave. But in The Guardian, perhaps Britain's most internationally famous newspaper these days, they always refer to people just by their last name, even if they've been knighted. So in their obituary of Sir Roger Moore, we got lines like, "Being eternally known as Bond has no downside," Moore told The Guardian. I looked up some of the other British papers to see what their standards were, based on their reporting of Sir Elton John's recent legal troubles with his ex-wife. The Telegraph, The Times, The Sun, The Mirror, and The Daily Mail all referred to him on second reference as Sir Elton. The Independent, like The Guardian, however, just called him John. I'm not exactly sure what this means, since calling him Sir Elton versus just calling him John doesn't really seem to correlate with anything like the seriousness of the publication or its political bent. In American newspapers, by the way, he is always just called John. The foreign press in general doesn't really recognize British knighthoods as being a legitimate part of somebody's name, which is a good segue into our next topic. The politics of sirs. So, the longest running controversy about knighthoods is just this allegation that they don't often go to the most deserving people. Indeed, the whole elaborate nature of the modern knighthood appointment process, with all of the committees and all the rest, has arisen specifically to bring greater accountability and transparency to a tradition that has often faced accusations of corruption and political bias. The most famous example of this occurred in the early 20th century under the prime ministership of David Lloyd George. Lloyd George, it was revealed, had used knighthoods as a way to fundraise for his political party. Just donate £400,000 or more, and the prime minister will see that you get made a sir. Between 1916 and 1922, David Lloyd George was accused of having sold over 1,500 knighthoods this way. Outrage over this is actually one of the reasons why good old Canada became the first nation of the British Empire to opt out of the knighthood system in 1919. Though there are a lot more checks and balances on the granting of knighthoods these days, there is still a perennial concern that a lot of people just get them because of their closeness with the ruling party. This is especially the case with the Prime Minister's resignation list, which remains one of Britain's most controversial traditions. Since this is the list that the Prime Minister has complete control over, it is common for Prime Ministers to make sirs out of like their advisors or their press secretaries or hacky people like that. In 2006, there was this whole controversy about how becoming a lord or a sir during the Tony Blair administration seemed to suspiciously correlate with making large donations to his political party. It's also a bit controversial that so many celebrities become sirs these days, a tradition that only really began in the latter half of the 20th century. This can be seen as cheapening the honor, but it can also just seem really arbitrary. Paul McCartney was made a sir, for instance, but George Harrison never was, and this was said to be something that he always resented. Patrick Stewart has been knighted, but Colin Firth hasn't. Mick Jagger has, but Eric Clapton hasn't. So the standards don't always seem really clear or consistent. There have also been a few cases where the government has had to take back knighthoods from men who have been disgraced by scandal. Most recently, some bankers involved in the 2008 financial crisis. But it honestly hasn't happened as much as I expected, given how many knighthoods are handed out these days. Perhaps more damaging to the prestige, however, is the famous people who have refused to be knighted, usually because they either don't respect the tradition or they don't like the British government of the day. David Bowie, Stephen Hawking, and Severus Snape himself, Alan Rickman, are all some examples of famous Brits who have said no to becoming a sir, which some might say make Brits who say yes look more needy or lame by comparison, which gets us to the perennial charge of elitism. This idea that making people sirs is like this vestigial remnant of feudalism or something with no place in a modern Britain. This particular debate is quite interesting right now because the current head of Britain's left-wing Labour Party is a sir. Sir Keir Starmer, a man who was knighted in 2014 for his previous service as Britain's chief federal prosecutor. Starmer is the first ever head of the British Labour Party to be a sir while in office. It is also the first time that either of Britain's two major political parties have been led by a sir since 1965, when the Conservatives were led by a guy named Sir Alec Douglas Home. Now, the opinion of the British left on things like knighthoods has always been a bit all over the place. Some see things like knighthoods as elitist symbols of the rigid British class system that they are trying to break down, while others see it as something that has evolved into a fairly innocuous tradition of celebrating British excellence. I feel like the following quote from Labour activist Kat Overton on the Labour List blog is probably a fairly representative sample of what A lot of people on the British left think about this sort of thing. I would argue that the archaic honor system has some merit to it, to the extent that it is used to recognize and express public gratitude for genuine, disinterested public service. But too often, the system is abused and used for party political patronage and the rewarding of misplaced loyalty within the civil service. Though Britain's system for granting titles of nobility was significantly reformed by Labour Party governments during the 20th century, the idea that the British government should continue to grant such titles has never been seriously threatened by any Labour administration. Indeed, it is very common for Labour Party politicians to be knighted or lorded after they leave office. But that said, the idea of having a current sir running to be the next Labour Party Prime Minister is a little different, and something that rubs some people the wrong way. But this is as much an issue of branding as anything else. I mean, if someone is a sir, it is generally a signal that they are some sort of big shot, and people don't want to vote for big shots. They want to vote for an everyman. And as a result, as far as I can tell, the British Labour Party is attempting to downplay Sir Keir Starmer's knighthood as much as possible. In their official propaganda on their website and their YouTube channel, they never refer to him as Sir Keir. It's always just Keir Starmer or plain old Keir, your mate. But it's also not something he can very easily hide from, since, like I said, most major British media outlets will always refer to him as Sir Keir, just because that's considered the proper way. And it is, like, his actual name, after all. He did agree for it to happen. He could have gone the David Bowie route, but he chose not to. Anyway, my closing question is for my British friends. Obviously, I want to hear your opinions on knighthoods, but I also want to ask you something more specific. Have you, in your British lives, ever dealt with a sir before? Like maybe somebody you worked under, or somebody who was employed by your school, or something like that? And if so, what were they like? And what did people call them? I am keen to hear. Do not forget to like and subscribe, and I will see you all next week.